Welcome everyone to the Ruth Institute second annual awards dinner here in Lake Charles, Louisiana. The Ruth Institute is a global nonprofit organization equipping Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. At the Ruth Institute, we believe that children need their own parents, and that every child deserves a relationship with their natural mother and father unless an unavoidable tragedy prevents it. Every person, without exception, deserves to know their cultural heritage and genetic identity. These rights of children place constraints on adult behavior around marriage and sex. Traditional Christian sexual ethics protects these rights of children and educates adults about their responsibilities. We can defend our religious beliefs based on reasons and evidence that anyone can observe for themselves. Of course, we can also defend our religious beliefs because they were revealed to us by God, who loves us and who wants what's best for us. So, just for the record, we are not officially a Catholic organization, although we generally have a lot of Catholics at these events. If you're not Catholic, don't worry. We're not going to worship statues or anything like that. It's going to be okay. Now, the ancient Christian teachings about marriage, family, and human sexuality are today sometimes regarded as exclusively Catholic, but in fact, Judaism and most Christian groups historically taught many of the same things. The Ruth Institute will work with individuals and groups, religious or otherwise, who share our views in whole or in part, regardless of their positions on other issues. For this year's theme of our summit, we have chosen "The Church Was Right All Along." And in part we chose this because this is the subtitle of my new book, The Sexual State. Now, I don't say this in any kind of triumphalist manner, that the church was right all along. Goodness knows the Catholic Church has plenty of problems right now. Our institutions have been corrupted, people are not living the church's teachings as they should be, and the clergy are not teaching the teachings as they should be. But still, it's still the case that the most reliable place to find the ancient Christian teaching about marriage, family, and human sexuality remains the Catechism of the Catholic Church. These teachings are the common heritage of all Christian churches. Professor Rodney Stark over at Baylor University has shown that Christianity grew in its early years of the Roman Empire in part because women were drawn to it. Women in the Roman Empire knew that if they married a Christian man, he would not force them to expose their babies to the elements. They knew if they had a Christian husband, he would not run off with another woman. They knew if they had a Christian husband, that that husband would protect their son from predatory homosexual activity. And therefore, women flocked to the Christian church. This is our common Christian heritage with very deep roots in Judaism. So our first award tonight is for scholarship. And if you're going to be an effective witness for the family, you really have to know what you're talking about. And that is why we, every year, try to honor scholars who have made significant contributions to our understanding of the family and traditional sexual ethics. Our honoree tonight certainly fits that description. If we're going to defend our religious beliefs about marriage, family, and human sexuality, it would be a good idea to know what they actually are. Robert Gagnon is currently a professor of New Testament theology at Houston Baptist University. Previously, he was a tenured associate professor of New Testament at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, teaching there for 23 years. He is also an ordained elder at the Presbyterian Church USA. We honor him tonight for his lifetime of work on the theology of St. Paul and on sexual issues in the Bible. As a service to the church, Dr. Gagnon provides a very large amount of free material on his website dealing with scripture and homosexuality. He's also the author of The Bible and Homosexual Practice, Texts and Hermeneutics, and he's co-author of a book on homosexuality in the Bible, Two Views. Dr. Gagnon is a longtime friend of the Ruth Institute. He used to speak every year at our college student conference that we called It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. And I learned a ton from him, and yeah, you got it, right. It takes a family to raise a village, yeah. I learned a lot from him, and the students loved him every year. In 2012, our friend Pastor Jim Garlow invited the Ruth Institute to hold that conference at his megachurch in San Diego on the grounds of Skyline Church. And I have no doubt at all that the reason Pastor Garland was interested was because he was so interested in Dr. Gagnon's scholarship on the Bible. Pastor Garland arranged for us to have a conversation on the definition of marriage hosted in the auditorium of his megachurch, which is like 3,000 people, something like that. It was huge. It was a huge venue. And Dr. Gagnon and I have it up here. This is the flyer that we had from 2012. Dr. Gagnon and I debated, or conversed, if you like, with the Episcopal Bishop Gene Robinson, who is openly gay. I don't know if you may remember Bishop Gene Robinson. He divorced his wife, married a man, caused enormous chaos inside the Episcopalian denomination, and then later divorced his husband. So it was kind of, but that hadn't happened yet at the time we debated him. Anyway, we debated them, and it literally in an audience of thousands. And in my personal, humble opinion, Dr. Gagnon and I trounced them. Nonetheless, as we know, the U.S. Supreme Court did redefine marriage for the entire country in 2015, and proponents of man-woman marriage have faced increasing marginalization in the culture. Dr. Gagnon's refutation of pro-gay theology has become, shall we say, increasingly unwelcome. He used to debate pro-homosexual theologians, but they don't invite him anymore because they don't consider the issue debatable. Dr. Gagnon taught with distinction at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary for 23 years. He is no longer there, and he has not spoken in any detail, publicly or privately, about that separation. Memo to Pittsburgh Theological Seminary. Dr. Gagnon has kept the terms of whatever non-disclosure agreement you may have made him sign, but we are not completely stupid. We can figure out what has gone on here. We can figure out why a man of his qualifications, with no scandal or anything negative in his record, is no longer working with you. You canned him because you could not refute his arguments, and you didn't want to live with the truth of his arguments on your campus. Well, that's my opinion. You know, don't you love how I sugarcoat things? You never know where you stand. So fortunately, Dr. Gagnon landed on his feet, as we all knew he would. He is now at Houston Baptist University. And we're very delighted that he will be in the I-10 corridor as our neighbor, basically. So please help me welcome Dr. Robert Gagnon, the Ruth Institute Scholar of the Year.
Situation at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary. We've not had any discussion about it one way or the other. These were your remarks, your comments.
Absolutely.
And the seminary and I mutually agreed that I would resign. I was unemployed at that point, and I had tenure until then, but we mutually agreed that I would resign, and that's all I
have to say.
Am going to say about it.
That's fine. That's right. But we're not completely stupid. We can. Hello? Okay. Anyway, let's not talk about that. Well, I think we should talk a little bit about some of the key points that you like to make in terms of refuting a pro-gay theology. Now, you're going to talk for 30 minutes tomorrow about this. You should all come back. So, no, don't do it all now. But I can think of several things that really stick in my mind that I learned from you, you know, when you were teaching the students all the time. But, you know, Just name one of your favorite points that you like to put out there for people.
Well, there are all sorts of arguments that are used. Actually, there are two different groups on the other side of this issue. One is trying to make the Bible serviceable to committed homosexual unions. And they will typically argue some form of revisionist argument that they didn't know about committed same-sex relationships in the ancient world, or they didn't know about any congenital causation factors for homosexual development. Or that this was just a way of keeping women down by not allowing some women to be in a dominant lesbian relationship or some men to be in a subordinate male homosexual relationship. Those are typical kinds of revisionist arguments. And what I do, part of what we'll do tomorrow, is look at whether or not those arguments are credible. Here's a hint, they're not. And they're not because you can find clear texts in the Greco-Roman and ancient Near Eastern milieu that indicate that they knew about committed same-sex unions, sometimes even semi-official marriages. They also posited in the ancient world some degree of influence, either through early childhood socialization or through congenital influences on homosexual development. And we know that Christianity, if you follow their argument, that it's only going to be a misogynistic reason why you would oppose homosexual unions, because you want to keep women down, would infer that Christianity is the most misogynistic religious movement in the ancient world. And we know, based on the biblical text, that's utterly false. In fact, it's one of the most liberating in the ancient world. So that can't work either. And that's one side. And then the other side quickly just says, well, you know what? We're going to be good historians, and we're going to candidly admit that there's nothing in the Bible that can be made serviceable to accepting committed same-sex unions. We're just going to disagree. And a classic example of that would be a New Testament scholar by the name of William Loader, L-O-A-D-E-R, who's an Australian New Testament scholar. He's written about 10 books on sexual ethics in early Judaism and Christianity, covering virtually every dimension. Nobody's written as much as he has on that general topic. I beat him on the homosexuality issue, but specifically, but on that general topic, he does all that. And he's a good enough historian to admit that the Bible cannot be made to support any kind of same-sex union. And in fact, when I discussed this with him in a Society of Biblical Literature annual meeting, he acknowledged, Dr. Gagnon, I agree with you, that Jesus would not have accepted any form of homosexual relationship, committed or otherwise, oriented or otherwise, and Jesus would not have accepted any of those. I just disagree with Jesus. So I thought, if that's the hill you want to die on, great, because actually it serves that purpose.
So one of the things that I remember in the development, because Rob and I have been kind of in these trenches for a number of years. When I started the Ruth Institute in 2008, I got involved in the same-sex marriage debate because it was happening right there in San Diego. And you could sort of see the arguments morph and kind of move along to where things are no longer debatable. You know, things that used to be, you used to be able to go and have a conversation about things, and then eventually that was no longer possible. So, Rob, I want to thank you so much for your work. I'm delighted. Are you, now tell us, are you going to relocate to Houston soon? Is that part of the plan?
Well, I will have to relocate, certainly, because I will be working there full-time starting in the fall.
Good.
But we're negotiating questions about the length of contract and will it be renewed. And if it's going to be renewed, then obviously we're going to be in Houston long-term. But if it's not going to be, then we'll have to see. So, for now, I will be in Houston.
Well, that is going to be a delight, don't you think, everybody, to have Dr. Gagnon.